Last night I'd invited a group of younger men to come together, Will Little, who is grew up in our church, is here very rarely now. He's a Major League Baseball umpire now, and one of the youngest to ever make it, and they travel 7 or 8 months out of the year, believe it or not. But he came and spoke to our guys last night, and they knew who he was, but he talked about Christ and being a leader. A Christian leader, and it was phenomenal. And the guys that are there, I mentioned this a couple weeks ago, the guys that are there, they're coming up as our young leaders. This church is in real good hands for the future, if it can survive the present. It's a joke toward me. But no, I'll kid aside, it's in real good hands for the future, and we just need to keep praying for these families. Tonight's Philippians. You know, I've been here in several weeks. The first time we're just going through a real quick look at every book of the New Testament to try to get a handle on it. I hope you're keeping these in the first few weeks. We had notebooks in here. We can still get you one if you want it. But I hope you're keeping all of these. Just flip through one page to help you here and there. And the Philippians is going to be fun tonight. I'm going to have to hurry, I think, to cover some things, but we'll fill in the blanks like this when we get to them, okay? But city of Philippi, and I just found this interesting. It's of no great spiritual reason, but the city of Philippi was named after the father of Alexander the Great. I just found that to be interesting. I'd like to go around naming towns after my dad, have that power, right? It'd be Pollyon, I guess. But Philippi was named after the father of Alexander the Great. And it's a city that's mainly Gentiles. Greek was the main language that was spoken there, although the official language was Latin because of the Roman influence, but it's under the Roman power. And the church was founded by the Apostle Paul on his second missionary journey. Now, like we did last week, I'm going to ask you to go into the book of Acts, and you may want to note this. It makes the scripture come alive when you just learn those simple things about what's going on. But Acts 16, verses 1 through 40 is all about being in Philippi. And I want you to see in verse 9 how this all came about. Acts 16, 9 says, "During the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, 'Come over to Macedonia and help us.'" Now, what's that got to do with Philippi? Let's help you understand what would be Greece today in the northern part. There was a region called Macedonia, and that would be like in this vision, God, or he saw a man asking him to come to Washington County or the Tri-City area. You know, but it would have had boundaries. Come to the state of Tennessee. But let's say come to Washington County and bring the gospel. And so he decided to do that. And if you're coming to Washington County to bring the gospel, what city would you go to? Johnson City, probably, right? And so he is going to a region called Macedonia, and the primary city there would be Philippi. So when you read Macedonia, he's going to Philippi, as you'll see here later. And this is a fabulous story. It's an absolutely fabulous story. I think it's one that's got a lot of humor in it. But it's a fabulous story of what happens when he gets there. It says, after Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once. Now, who's we? Who wrote Acts and who wrote Luke? That ought to give you the answer. Who wrote Luke? Who wrote Acts? Luke, okay. So anywhere in Acts you read we, Luke is with him. He's in on it. They call the we sections. So he said, after Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to him. So you see him sitting over breakfast and saying, guys, here's what we got to do. I had this vision. I'm an apostle. This is what we got to do. And they all load up and go. He said, so from Troas, and it wasn't just walking down the street. From Troas, we put out to sea and sailed straight for Samothrace, I think. And the next day we went to Neapolis. And from there we traveled to Philippi, a Roman colony in the leading city of that district, you see, of Macedonia. And we stayed there several days. Now, this you learn a lot here about how the church was established. On the Sabbath, that would be a Jewish day of worship, right? On the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate to a river where we expected to find a place of prayer. What normally would be in a city that the Jews would go to pray? What location?
Synagogue.
Okay, which is sort of a, what word am I looking for? A drive-in temple. Okay, branch of the temple. But there wasn't one there. Does anybody know why there wouldn't be one there? What was required to have a synagogue?
A quorum. What, 60 men?
So many men. There had to be so many Jewish men. And obviously there wasn't. Now, ladies, I want you to pay attention to the next part. There wasn't a man in town that wanted to pray. So they go out to the river where we expect to find a place of prayer. We sit down and begin to speak to the women who had gathered there. And one of those listening was a woman from the city of Thyatira, which would be right there in that region, named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth. That was her business, and she's probably wealthy. That word purple would say that. She was a worshiper of God. She had no idea who Jesus was. She had been probably a proselyte who had converted to Judaism, and she just wanted to worship God, this living God, Yahweh. But she did not yet understand who Jesus was. So the Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. And Paul's message would be, you know who God is, let me tell you about Jesus. About God's Son, about God dwelling among us. So she opened her heart to that. And when she and the members of her household were baptized, she invited us to her home. If you consider me a believer in the Lord, she said, come and stay at my house. And she persuaded us. So she probably was a lady of and a family of means that was able to say, we'll host you while you're doing this. So there's trust, there's faith, there's answering this vision he'd had at night, this conviction he had that that's where he should go. And then this next part is just so interesting. Once when we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a female slave who had a spirit by which she predicted the future. She earned a great deal of money for her owners by fortune telling. Okay? Now it gets funny to me. She followed Paul and the rest of us, shouting, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you a way to be saved. Now that sounds good, doesn't it? But you can imagine Paul saying, I'd like to talk to you all about where you are. These men are servants of God. And he just starts screaming. You know, just he's trying to meet them where they are, and she's following everywhere yelling this over and over and over. And so look what happens. She kept this up for many days. Paul's getting pretty ticked, frustrated. Not that anybody preaching would ever get frustrated. Okay? I'll tell you a good frustration story, preaching, because I can tell it now, it's been long enough. And nobody's sitting in here that did it. But there were two or three teenage girls, I've maybe told you before, that were texting every week while I was preaching, and I knew it. And they just sat there next to each other and text. Back and forth. Well, her mom got in on it. And I thought, I'm going to have fun with this. So I put all four of them in my phone and laid it up here in the pulpit and said, would you please quit texting while I'm preaching? And I got the sermon and noticed them all looking down. Got the sermon, noticed it again, gave them a little time, and I went. So we turned to Acts, and I just hit send. We turned to Acts, and I said, I thought it was pretty good. And I usually don't notice things like that, but that one I had fun with. She followed Paul and the rest of us, shouting, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. She kept this up for many days. And finally, Paul became so annoyed that he turned around and said to the Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her. And at that moment, the Spirit left her. Now, can't you see? In the name of Jesus, would you shut up, is what he was saying. Now, he said it a little more palatable to her. I'm trying to talk to these people, and you're screaming all the time. Okay? Anyway. There's another story I could tell you, but I don't know. You want to hear another one real quick?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. There was a minister, and I'm going to ask him if you know him, because he's been gone a long time ago, named Johnny Hall. How many of you know Johnny Hall? Okay. Now, Johnny, if you knew him well, Johnny's character. He's character. And I've been at camp with him with kids. He's hilarious. But when he'd come in the church and you were young, he'd show up at Carter, and I'm this young preacher, and you'd start shaking. And you always were obliged, back in those days, there's a guest preacher calling to close the prayer, right? Okay. Johnny, will you lead us in prayer? He'd pray for 15 minutes, corrected everything you'd said in the sermon. Calm you down, he's a young preacher. And then he'd go to some guys in church and say, y'all hadn't had me for a revival in a while. He's a great guy, that's just how he's funny. And so that night, it seems I told Johnny he could come next spring to a revival. Okay. But anyway, he was preaching one time, and this lady got up when he'd be preaching, and she'd start speaking in tongues and just interrupting everything. And she'd sit down. Next night, she did the same thing. She'd sit down, stand up again in the middle of the sermon. He got frustrated, and he said, lady, would you sit down and shut up? And she said, yes. And she sat down, and he stood there a minute. He said, now, if you think that's the Holy Spirit, do you think she'd have sat down? You know, so anyway. But anyway, that's Johnny. Okay. Please don't read anything into that story other than it really happened, okay? So Paul is rather frustrated. And he says, at that moment, the Spirit left her. She got quiet. Now, here's poor old Paul. He thinks, okay, now I got this worked out here in Philippi. I can preach finally. God's called me to. He said, when her owners realized that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them in the marketplace to face the authorities. They brought them before the magistrates and said, these men are Jews and are throwing our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice. They were not doing any of that. Okay, but that's the charges. So the crowd joined in the attack. There's never a, you know, somebody's upset, there's always a crowd that will come around and throw a few things. So the crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. And after they'd been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. And when he received these orders, he put them in the inside cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. All Paul said was, well, you let me preach. And gets the tar beat out of him and thrown in jail. Okay? And it even gets better. So about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Good men. And the other prisoners were listening to them, so they're preaching in the prison, right? And suddenly there was such a violent earthquake, the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up. When he saw the prison doors open, he drew his swords about to kill himself, because he thought the prisoners had escaped. He'd have to probably die for that. But Paul shouted, don't kill yourself, we're all here. The jailer called for lights, rushed in and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What can you learn from that whole story? At that point,
God's going to do what he's going to do.
Wherever you are, God's put you in the right place. Right? We get all up there and fuss about everything. But poor old Paul just said, could you hold it down a minute, sort of, and he ends up beat up and thrown in jail. But then the gospel spread. So they replied, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you'll be saved, you and your household. And then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them, washed the wounds, and then immediately he and all his household were baptized. If you have any questions about baptism, look where it fits in. The jailer brought them into his house and he set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he'd come to believe in God, he and his whole family. And when it was daylight, the magistrates sent their officers to the jailer with the order, release these men. Now, Paul will not leave good enough alone. And I think for the sake of the gospel, but I love this story. He would not leave good enough alone. And they say, release these men. The jailer told Paul, "The magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. Now you can leave, go in peace." Stop right there. What had they done to Paul?
Beat him and put him in jail without a trial.
They beat him and put him in jail, and he was a blank citizen. What? Roman. He wasn't Jewish. Now, he's a member of the Sanhedrin. He apparently had a Roman father, a Jewish mother, and so he had sort of like a dual citizenship, and he thinks, "I'm not going to leave it alone," because guess what was amazingly against the law for a Roman to beat a Roman? And he said, "Okay, you guys can go now." I love what Paul does. Go in peace. He won't leave it alone now. Paul said to the officers, "They beat us publicly without a trial, even though we're Roman citizens, and threw me into prison. And now they want to get rid of us quietly? No. Let them come themselves and escort us out." These are real people. Isn't that a great story? Tell them to come down here themselves. My back's sore where they beat me. Now I'm a Roman. The officers reported this to the magistrates, and when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, they were alarmed. You know what the punishment was if a Roman beat a Roman? You get the pulp beat out of you too. They came to appease them and escorted them from the prison, requesting them to leave the city. After Paul and Silas came out of prison, they went to Lydia's house where they met with the brothers and sisters and encouraged them. Then they left. So it's a great story. That should be a half hour movie of some sort. Now, this gives you, I hope, by just hearing that story straight from the scripture, a much better view of who the letter Philippians written to. It's real people. Lydia, her family, this jailer and his family, other people who had become Christians, a small handful, this church is getting ready to take off, and he writes them. What this can help us to see, and if you go to Acts 16, verse 15, is probably, I think I've got the right verse, is probably that the church started in Lydia's house. "If you consider me to be a believer in the Lord," she said, "come and stay at my house," and she persuaded us. And so this church started in her house and started moving out. First church I ever served full time started in a house and exploded. It went from an upstairs living room to a closed in basement garage to some walls being knocked out to a small building. It's interesting. People, they poured their life into it. Their passion is there. And churches start that way. And that's how this one started, as did most one time or another started. The church in Florida had the privilege of serving was started basically by two ladies, one from Kingsport and one from over in Sullivan County. One in Sullivan County met a man at Milligan and they married, and she moved to Florida with him. And that's Corey Webb's grandmother, grandfather. And then Mitch and Helen Penley. Mitch wasn't a Christian at the time, but Helen was. And Helen and Betty met in Titusville, and they were both Christian church background. There was no church. And they got together and said, "We need to start a church." And they started a little fellowship, basically them and their children, who were little children at the time, and are in their 50s and 60s now. And they met with them and started having the Lord's Supper. And J.J. Music, who some of you would know from this area, went down and preached some for them. And then a Mr. Jones started preaching for them, that moved to Florida to help them get started, and started two or three churches and go around on circuit-wise in the late 50s. And that church started in a home. And when Jill and I moved up here, it was 500 plus people. So just keep in mind, I visited a church on an Apache reservation back in the late 90s, mid 90s, and there was a man there that had been won to Christ and was the sheriff and became the president of the Apache Nation. And he became a Christian, and he started in a church that had medicine men and totem poles and everything, and he realized I had nothing to do with that and went out and started worshiping Christ with he, his wife, his mother-in-law, and two or three children. And the last time I knew of that church, it was several, 300 or 400 people, Apache Indians, that were worshiping Christ. So just look how churches start, how fellowship starts, how everything can grow. And I want to see that tonight, because I think everybody here, we come together as a church on Sunday morning, not even all together at the same hour. And God be praised for that, that we've had that growth. But every one of us can be a part of those small places where real ministry and the love of each other can be shown personally, as was done here. And I personally think both are needed. But anyway, it's a great story. You got to admit, it's a great story. Philippians, let's go, since that's the book we're talking about. Go to Philippians. But I think that makes it come alive. Now, I want you to see just a handful of things from Philippians tonight. The first part of Philippians, and I'm just giving you sort of an outline. Philippians 1, 12 through, and this is, remember last week, Ephesians was not very personal. It's just a general letter, but Philippians is very personal. He starts this letter out over his and Timothy's name, and all they did with letters then was put their name at the first instead of signing them at the end, which when you think about it makes a lot more sense. But Philippians 1, 12 through 26, he tells them how he's doing. Now, it's great to have people that he could tell them how he was doing. The way I worded that, how are things for Paul? That's the one I couldn't remember how I worded. How are things for Paul? And that's the first part of the letter. So you notice that he says, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. He'd been imprisoned. Poor old Paul got thrown in prison all the time. And 13, he says, as a result, it's become clear throughout the whole palace guard and everyone else that I'm in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. And then he talks about how some, you know, preach it the wrong way and all. But you've got to admire Paul. He says it's true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I'm put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition. They are not sincere, not real believers, supposing they stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. That is a man's man. That is a leader. That is a God-filled man. I don't have human enemies. If they're talking about Jesus, their motives are wrong, God will deal with that. I'm just glad God's being talked about. Christ is being preached. So that's the first part. Second part is Philippians 1, 18 and 4, 2 through 3. And I want us to read these and I'll give you how to fill them in. 18, but what does it matter? The important thing that is in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, how many of you can sing that? Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, again I say rejoice. Okay. You hear me, you know why some churches are non-music. Anyway, that, and then go to 4.
Chapter 4,
verses 2 and 3. This is sad, but you've got to admire what he's doing. You've got to admire. And there is a huge lesson to be learned here. I plead with Euodia, it's a lady's name, and I plead with Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, okay, probably Timothy at this point, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. What's he pleading with those ladies to do?
Stop fussing with each other.
Stop fussing. Quit picking at each other. Quit finding out what's wrong. You know, The church will always have people who come in to just tell you what's wrong. Don't be one of them. They'll always be in the church. I hope they are, because they're not, means we're not doing much. But when somebody comes in to tell you what's wrong, just don't be one of them, okay? And notice how he's pleading here. Now, he gives them, and we'll look at this in a second, he gives them some very serious ways to do this. But I want you to fill number two in, and we can hammer it every Wednesday night, every Sunday morning, and not overhammer this whole point for the church, because I think we're addressing the number one tool of Satan. Number two, fill it in this way: unity, unity, unity. That's what that whole thing's about. The church can set the world on fire when the church is unified. And you can destroy a church if you get the leaders just divisive a little bit. If you can get some families mad at other families just a little bit and start, you know. And somebody made the point one time, more houses are destroyed by termites than woodpeckers. And they were talking about from within. They were making that application to the church. Nobody outside the doors of this church can hurt this church. I honestly believe that in my heart. Nobody. Not Putin. Nobody. But any one or two of us could really cause trouble, which will deal with people's eternity. So unity, unity, unity is of overwhelming importance. And just now, let's go and look at some of the things he says in the book about how to accomplish unity. It's some cool stuff. But let's fill in the blanks first and come back to that. Philippians 2:19 through 30, he uses this time to commend Timothy to them. I skipped 3:2-3, and the following verses. Number 3 warns against false teaching. And it's interesting, if you go to number 3, warns against false teaching, that next he commends Timothy to them. And I think you'll see again the natural progression of what is happening here is, I'm warning you against false teachers. They'll try to divide you. That'll be the number one thing they'll do. They'll try to split you apart on whatever lines they can. And when you think about the things usually argued about in the church, and I'll give you two real examples. I know one church that just got hammered, lost 150 or 200 people, set back their momentum for years, because they got an argument over whether the piano and the organ would sit down on this level or up on this level. And I know where that happened. And it really hurt the church. I know of another one, the story was told to me, of a church in Kentucky, a little country church that had a coal pile outside and heated the church years ago with a coal furnace. And they got ahead a little bit of money and decided they would build an internal coal bin. It would snow on it, rain on it, and all. And they got an argument over, should we build this little room around it and open the door up, you know, and all, or should we spend the money some other way? And everybody got in a big argument, and the church split. And somebody went down and wrote, after they built it, and went down and wrote on the door, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, two coal piles. Making their point. There's two churches needing two coal piles now. And so when you hear what people can get upset over, never have I heard anything of consequence. So he warns them against false teachers who come in and try to divide. So it's only natural that now he's going to say, Timothy's going to come and talk to you, and I want to tell you Timothy's okay. So this letter's being written. You say, Timothy's, he's a good guy. You've never met him. But I can tell you, I know Timothy. I know his mother. I know who his grandmother was. And Timothy just became so powerful in the early work. So if you go to Philippians 2, 19 through 30, look what he says. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare. For everyone looks out for their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy's proved himself because as a son with his father, and he's talking about Timothy with him, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope therefore to send him soon as I see how things go with me, and I'm confident in the Lord that I myself may come soon. But anyway, it's I think a little bit emotional, cool. Any word you want to put with it, the way he commends Timothy to be somebody who really helped this church. It's supposed to rain tonight. Either that barrel or the air conditioner just took off. And then Philippians 4, 10 through 20. It's supposed to quit raining.
Just turned to snow.
Yeah. Nothing like a thunderstorm in February, isn't it? Philippians 4, 10 through 20 is his own personal thanksgiving. This is where the famous verse, I've learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether I'm well-fed, hungry, living in plenty, or in want. And I do all things through him who gives me strength. And then he goes on, yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. So he thanks them for what they did, and then gives his final greetings. Now, the meat of this letter is found, I personally believe, in Philippians 2. And if you go back to that unity, 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 the false teaching, everything, he puts it all in a nutshell, verse 5 of chapter 2. And I'd mark this in my Bible, write it up here, something, a nutshell of Philippians. Verse 5, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset of Christ Jesus. So if that statement of Scripture breeds a question, always ask that next question when you read something. Say, well, that's good. I should have the mindset of Jesus. What's the natural question? What's the mindset of Jesus? I want it. What is it? And then he tells us, even though, verse 6, he in very nature was God. Now that's powerful stuff. He did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Now, that's powerful stuff. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. And that's the mindset of Christ, is I'm going to be humble around everybody. I may be angry, I'm not going to return the venom. The attack may be unfounded, I'm just going to walk away and smile. You know, it's not worth it to ever do battle, brothers in Christ. Okay? And we cannot overemphasize that, because I think that's how Satan would hit a church anytime. I want to find something wrong, you know. And so this mindset of Christ is what we want everybody to have. And then he goes on and says, because he was obedient like that, talking about Jesus, exalting the highest place, gave the name above every name, the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. They don't yet. In heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledges Jesus, Lord, the glory of the Father. Another place says they will bow. And then he goes on and tells us, don't grumble. Now, have any of you, has anybody here ever grumbled? Huh? Many times? Okay. Let me ask you another question, because I hate personal questions, but I love the ones I answer about other people. Have you ever heard anybody grumble? Let me ask another question. Do any of you know Roger Gregg? Now, I'm not saying the questions go together. No, but I'm kidding aside. Well, grumble. If you always obey, not only my presence now, much more now, continue to work out your salvation, fear and trembling, for his God working. Do everything without grumbling, without arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God, without fault in a warped and crooked generation. then we'll shine like them stars in the sky. Now, I want to close with that idea. If we don't grumble, and that's not that hard to do. It's not that hard to not grumble. It really isn't. If we love Christ. If we don't grumble, or when we realize we are, say, I'm sorry. You know. If we're that type of person, look what it says. You'll be blameless and pure, and then this quotation, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky. Please, please, please grab this. And I'm going to say it the way I've said it before. I don't know how in the English language, any language, for us to adequately grasp what he's telling us here. But you know, and I know, that we live in a crooked and warped generation. And what's this say about the church? Should we be wringing our hands? What's it say? Huh? Unity, be a light to that world. We're dealing with elementary age children that their world's collapsing. We're dealing with middle school and high school, world's collapsing, college age, and adults. There's no difference anymore. And if the church comes together, you know, I want to share with you real quick when Kyle and I got together today, and it's working with LXI, we were talking about how can we come along beside you. And I told him, I said, here's a pet peeve of mine I want to share with you before we talk any further. We don't want to tell you what to do. This is your dream. And what you're doing with those young people in the city of John City is great. We want to just stand back. And if you need us, tell us what you need us to do. We're not wanting to absorb you. This is your dream that God gave you. God called him to go to Macedonia, you know, work with these kids. And I said, but what can we do to encourage you? And the things that came out of it were absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. No real talk of money. But he said, we built this whole thing on relationships. These kids have no relationships with anybody. He said, I just need people to come. And I told you this before, no matter what age, and just hang out with them on Tuesday nights. And so we started brainstorming and thinking of things we could do. I said, could we pick a child up if a couple wanted to and say, you know, we drive by that area, we leave 15 minutes earlier today and drive swing through that area and bring this young man and his brother, little sister, whoever, to church with us. And he said, that would be wonderful with one caveat. Don't pick them up, take them to church, bring them home, and kick them out. He said, take them to lunch with you. Get them early enough to eat breakfast with you or something. He said, they've got to see what Christians are like. And I thought, wow, that's easy. That's easy. Go pick a young person up. And Eric went last night, was there, and he was helping them with worship. They had 103, I think they said, young people. And they spoke to them. They had worship time. He led that. And they spoke to them. And they broke into small groups. And the size of the groups determined the number of adults that were there. And they talked about some heavy stuff. And these kids' lives are falling apart. And Eric asked if he could come. He took one of the boys home, went, knocked on the door, met the parents' door, said, do you mind if I picked him up, took him to church? And no, I don't care if you take him. They didn't ask, who are you anyway? So he went and got the child tonight, three of them, brought him to church with him. He's going to bring him in Sunday early. So people can do, there's all sorts of things like that we can do. Right? And that's being that light in a warped and crooked world. So there's more and more opportunities like that we hear about all the time. Or God's place in your heart in Macedonia. But I guarantee you Macedonia is not to complain. Your Macedonia is to build up and encourage everybody you come in touch with. And that's a beautiful letter because of that. Okay. Comments? Questions? Anything? We're done, but it's still raining. Anybody needs a walk to the car? David Swanker, you got a jacket? He'll hold it over your head and walk you to the car. Okay, Jim Hughes, got a jacket? Okay. You can give him an insurance card, Jim.
Got it.
Okay. Let's stand and close with prayer. Scott, please.
Heavenly Father God, thank you so much for this time tonight, Lord, for this lesson today. God, I pray that we would each go out and be your light and serve you as you would have us serve, God. We thank you for your sacrifice in Son Jesus. God, we just pray everything through his name.
I don't know.